we need to do this with the roster. So what is that aspect of it like?
Well, I would say this. It's not that I don't want to be their friend. I would love to be their friend. What I don't want to be is I don't want to be somebody in their mind that doesn't talk the truth to them. And so, therefore, I don't want them never not to believe. They may not like what I have to say, but as long as they can trust what I say and they trust me and respect me and the decisions that I'm making, they may not like them. But one of the biggest concerns is that I have is I want to do it right. I want to do it right on the personal side because this is a business. And so it's always a battle to try to do it correct, right on the personal side and be honest with the player. And so they don't look at you as saying, well, he speaks out of both sides of his mouth. That's the last thing I want. And the last thing I want is a reputation, is that those players can't trust what comes out of my mind. So therefore, that's why it's hard for me to get too close to the players. And because I don't want to be, because it's very easy to get close and personally get connected with people. Coaches, that happens to coaches. And because they're working with them every day. And so that's human nature, especially if you like somebody. And so a lot of times those personal things can get in the way. And when they do, it's very, very difficult to make that decision. It makes it harder. So therefore, I try not to get too close. It's not that I don't – I would love it because I loved being in that locker room when I played. And that's probably the thing I miss the most, is not being able to be in that locker room and be close and be involved, those type of things. And so I got to be more removed. But I do that because it's the best thing for the player. It's the best thing for the Broncos and for me to be able to be objective and make the right best decision for a football team, because I've got to make the best decision for everybody, not just one guy. And so, you know, like I said, it's not about being a friend, but it's about having that respect. And so I don't ever want to be put in a position that I'm telling them something that I don't mean.
This is the MMQB podcast.
You know, for Joe Fan, it can be a hassle getting a seat to a game or a concert, especially for a good price. That's why the best place to go when you need tickets is SeatGeek. It's so easy, I have used it. I mean, if I can do this, you can do it. They pull all the tickets available on other sites into one place. You save time. You never miss a deal. You can set alerts for upcoming events, and they'll let you know if ticket prices fall. Even better, every ticket on SeatGeek is ranked based on value, so you can immediately find the underpriced seats. And you can also use SeatGeek's detailed maps to see the view from your seat. What's best is that SeatGeek is always honest and upfront about the price. They show you the full ticket price from start to finish. They will never try and trick you with big fees at checkout. Now pay attention to this next part because it's quite important. My listeners, the listeners to this podcast, get a $20 rebate off their first SeatGeek purchase. That's $20 right in your pocket. And to get it, all you have to do is this. Download the free SeatGeek app, go to the settings tab and click add a promo code. Then enter promo code MMQB. SeatGeek will then send you $20 after you've made your first ticket purchase. It just doesn't get any easier. Download the free SeatGeek app and enter promo code MMQB today. Now, back to our show.
So, this fascinates me about the whole Peyton Manning thing. You don't want to be the friend necessarily, but in 2012, you had to convince him that Denver was the best place for him to resuscitate his career, that he could win a Super Bowl here. Not only could he win one, but you built a team that went to the Super Bowl twice, won one in his 4 years. So you do that, and he comes here. So obviously there's this great relationship. And then you have to go to him and ask him to take a salary haircut in his last year. So how difficult was that for you to do, knowing that Manning had done so much for this franchise?
Yeah, and that was hard. I mean, that's always hard. But I guess the way that I looked at it is I look at from my world and where he was and saying, okay, putting myself back in a situation of, Peyton, what do you want to do? Do you want to try to win another world championship? Because I've only got so much money I can spend. And so I'm not trying to put
you ended up being able to buy Evan Mathis.
We got Evan Mathis. We got Evan Mathis, and Peyton got his money.
Yeah, he
so,
did.
I mean, everything worked
well,
out.
Well, because you worked it out so that if you get to the Super Bowl, win the Super Bowl, he does get that money back.
Right.
And it did work out.
It worked out great. And so he got all his money, and it, you know, so it worked out perfect. But the goal was to try to put the best team. And I could, I only had so much money that I could work with. And so I was just trying to blend the team. And I knew offensive line-wise, you know, we needed some help there. And so with what Peyton agreed to get back. Now, I will tell you this. If Peyton had said no, Peyton Manning would have still been on this team.
Yeah.
So it was up to Peyton, right? This was not a take it or we're going to cut you type thing. It was, hey, Peyton, you know, and I'm sure he's looking at it saying, well, the Denver Broncos got plenty of money too. Well, I'm looking at my budget. So yeah. Wherever, somewhere in between where it all worked
that
out.
That brings up this point. Okay, so I could really see Peyton Manning doing your job because I can't see him doing TV. Maybe for a while, but long term, he's like you. He's got to win.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, so I don't know, 3 years down the road, is it going to be Elway against Manning, running teams this time?
You know, I think, obviously he's got the tools to do it. Let's put it that way. I mean, but I will tell you this, the biggest adjustment that you have in my position now compared to playing the quarterback position is the amount of control. And I always say this, you control all everything outside the lines, okay? Outside the football field, because you're really in control of your football team, who's going to be on a football team, in most situations, depending on who the head coach is, you know, and you get some say on the coaches, and so you got all that control. But once they kick that thing off,
you got no control.
There's no control. And Peyton is, I would say this, he likes a little bit more control than I necessarily needed at the time and when I was a player. Maybe
you were not a control freak the way he is. He's the all-time control freak.
Right. So how he's going to handle that in this situation, well, you know, if he gets in the situation he wants, you know, we'll see how he handles that. Because it is, you have to trust in other people. And the control is not yours, and you give it to the other people. And you got to hire people, and you got to trust them and give them the rope to go do their deal.
With John Elway, the architect of the Denver Broncos, on the MMQB podcast with Peter King. A few more with John. So, John, what was more difficult? Was it more difficult winning a Super Bowl as a quarterback, or was it more difficult building a team to win a Super Bowl when you're sitting upstairs just watching the games?
You know, it's I will say this. As a player, it's very the accomplishment is much greater because you're right in the middle of everything and you got your hands on the ball and you're in the team. And it's hard work because you're out there and physically, you're putting the work together, you know. In my position now, it's not nearly as much physical. It's not even close to the physical yet. My body feels much better on Monday now than it used to. But now it's more of just your gut feeling of different people and taking what you like. And I think I got a big advantage because I take what I liked in coaches. And so I watch coaches now. And that's to me, because I know what I liked and what I didn't like in different coaches, it's easy for me to evaluate coaches because I know what I liked. Mm-hmm. And I was fortunate to have great coaches. You know, I played for Dan Reeves and those staffs. We went to 3 Super Bowls and then, two with Mike. So I got exposed, and then my dad. So I got exposed to so many different kinds of coaches, and so I knew what I liked. And so that helps me there. And then as far as players and kind of guys I like to play with, and I would tell you this, everyone talks about the money and where the money is, but I find out a lot about a guy when I'm negotiating with him. And the type of player when I'm negotiating them, because I'm finding out not only, I want to be fair with everybody. I want everybody to be secure and make a living and, be secure for the rest of their life. But it's also important for me that I want to find the right guys who want to win championships.
What did you find out when you were negotiating with Von Miller?
Well, I think it's a lot of times in the situation that he was,
because he got hot at times.
He got, well, I guess. I mean, you never know, right? Because I talked to Von. I mean, there's so many different things that go, and there's so many rumors that go on, especially in a situation like that where it's high profile.
Yeah.
That there's so many people talking out there, it's really difficult. Sometimes you just got to kind of close yourself in and stay out of the fray because there's, Von's quitting or Von's not going to get a play again. And, ultimately, we were going to get a deal done with Von. Agents also have different ideas sometimes than players, right? So you got to kind of get through that too.
So what did you find out about Von Miller in this process?
I knew Von wanted to be here. And I think what I've seen and what I'm really excited about it is, where Von's coming out of that. And the fact is he's not coming out satisfied. He's coming out now wanting to prove that he deserved that money. And so, because he played great, obviously, in his first 5 years, but now he wants to become. And that's when I sat down with him. I said, Von, you're on the stage now where you're creating a legacy because you've proven you can play great. But to play great, and your legacy comes from playing great for a long time. And so now you're in the legacy mode. And that's why it's, you know, important for you to continue to play great. And if it be important for you, you'll be rich forever in your life, and you can go down as one of the best players to ever play in the NFL. And so, but that's up to you. And that's what I'm really excited about Vaughn and the conversation that we've had, that he's not just saying, okay, I got the money, I'm good. He now wants to prove, you know, what kind of football player he is. And so that's why it's exciting getting started this Thursday and watch him come out and see what he does.
John, you have done a good job at the bottom of drafts and in free agency. Since you've been in Denver, Julius Thomas in the fourth round, Malik Jackson in the fifth round, Danny Trevathan in the sixth round, Trevor Siemian in the seventh round, Chris Harris Jr., one of the best corners in football, as an undrafted free agent. Why do you emphasize the late rounds so much here?
You know, I think I saw a stat yesterday, and it said there are more CFAs on rosters in the NFL. Undrafted free agents in the NFL than there are first and second rounders. Wow. And I think, and I can't, the number's around 480, and it's really close. But if you look at that number, you know, it's, that just goes to show you right there the importance of, you know, what you're getting later in the round and how, the importance of that. Now, I will say this. I've got a great staff. You know, we all work together and got a lot of really good evaluators and scouts. And so they're a tremendous help. And I think one thing that we do talk about is it's everybody has an opinion and no opinion's wrong. And so no one's afraid to speak up. And I think that that's the culture that I want. And that's, I think, what's helped us be able to come away with the drafts that we've had, because we're getting the right kind of players. And I will, you know, Peter, it's also important. The other thing that's very important is you got to have great coaches, because you don't draft these kids. They're still kids when they come out.
I got to tell you, you know what really has impressed me with Gary Kubiak as a coach? What's impressed me is that in 2015, with Peyton Manning clearly in decline, he understands when he's got to take him out, and he understands that Peyton Manning has to show him beyond the shadow of a doubt that he's better than Brock Osweiler for him to go back in the game. He does that. There's some tense times, obviously. Manning wants to play earlier. But then, you know, you end up winning the Super Bowl. And then this year, Kubiak says, entering the offseason, we will play the best guy. And so everybody said, I remember I called Patrick Smythe, your PR guy, and I said, come on, Patrick, he's just saying that. You know, tell me. He says, no, he says Gary Kubiak is, this is an open level playing field of a competition. And he ended up playing the guy who nobody thought he would play, right? Trevor Siemian. So is that you also? Do you want guys to go out there regardless of draft pedigree? You got Mark Sanchez, first-round pick. You got Paxton Lynch, first-round pick. You got Trevor Siemian, the 9,000th player picked in the 2015 draft. And Siemian wins the job.
You know, Peter, I'll say this. In talking about Gary, and if you listen to Gary and you listen to how he talks and when he talks, number one, he's got a great feel for players and their psyche. He's got a great, great feel for that, best I've ever seen. As far as just when to practice them, when not to practice them, how he deals with them. And when he went through last year with Peyton and Brock, you know, obviously we had discussions all the time, and Peyton was overthrown, trying to get healthy and doing those type of things. But and when it came down to Peyton was finally getting back healthy, is when I kind of stepped back. And I just said, Gary, what do you think? He says, I want to go with Peyton. And I didn't ask why. And he didn't have a reason. He just said, John, it's just in my gut. I think that's the way we should go. And at that point in time, he made the change. And I didn't question it, you know, because he's got that great feel of when players are ready to go, when they're not, and the psyche.
But I think also, don't you also think that part of it is when players or ex-players are talking about this? I remember asking you in 2012, so John, why did Peyton choose the Broncos? And you said, I don't know. You'd have to ask him.
Right.
I said, you've never asked Peyton Manning why he chose the Denver Broncos? He says, no. He's here. That's what's important. Right. Now, maybe in the intervening years, you ask.
Plus,
him,
I don't think Peyton would ever tell me anyway.
Right.
He holds everything so close anyway. But.
But I think that's a mark of players and of ex-players. Whereas I'm so curious. Hey, John, why did you do this? Why did you do that? Well, maybe you'd talk about it, but it's not like you are going to talk about it among yourselves a lot of times.
Right.
You know.
Yep. Yeah. No question. And back to.